Oui, oui. Oui, je vais laisser le temps
so
à mes panélistes.
Give the time for my fellow panelists to sit down. But we are going to have a hard time, perhaps, concluding today with a debate to try to ask the fairly simple question: how can we incorporate the food and nutritional security within the climate change in the end of December? And perhaps let's add a few elements. We've had a very rich day today. We might remember that there are a lot of political opportunities, which are whether it's the COP21, but also the other regional reports on agriculture and the agenda for solutions, the issue of funding, and the opportunities are there. And we saw this throughout the day, that we can no longer ignore the intrinsic link between agriculture and climate change, because it's going to have a bigger impact on the climate change, but also the role in emissions. And we have the difficult time how politically we can incorporate this double imperative to live in a world to change the way that we consume without having an impact, but on the contrary, in reinforcing the commitment. We talk about the complexity of the issue, and we're going to now discuss that when we talk about the food and nutritional security in policies. We're talking about a lot of things. I think all the accounts that we heard today, we talk about agriculture, funding, and participation, and this brief, in fact, talked about by the previous panel. And so how can we embody these various elements in a political agenda and in political decisions for the future? And we talked about the COP21 and the difficulty to be able to incorporate nutritional and food security in the agenda. And we talked about the existing policies, and we're going to see if we're going to be able to manage to draw lessons from our failures, from our successes. And food security is for adaptation or for mitigation. So many questions which are going to be up to this panel to try to make conclusions on for the coming months and months for building up to the summit conference in the end of December. And so to answer these questions, we have a rich family. We have Issi Boyama, who is a delegate to the UNFCCC from Niger, and with the government, and especially in terms of climate. Yeah, Ludovic Labordière, who is climate and agriculture project officer for the Ministry of Agriculture, Agribusiness and Forestry. Ali Abdou Bougueray is representative of the EDR Niger, Climate and Development Network. And Ludovic Labordière, I've already said him, works in France and is a negotiator. And with the United Nations. And so I'll give the floor to Ival. What are you are the key elements? We talked about the different policies and the different issues. What are some of the issues which we have to really, if we want to reach nutritional and food security, what are the crucial elements, or are there any red lines in facts that we have to be careful not to cross, that is, taking into consideration false solutions and for political considerations?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for all of you. You stick with us since early in the morning. It was a very excellent day for me. And I learned, or I sort of revitalized my information about the climate change and food security. It is important for me this because my next report will be presented in UN Security Council, but it is not UN Security Council. This is a kind of Freudian slip, and UN General Assembly in October, and the subject is right to food and the climate change. And so I would like to invite all of you, if you have any information, any report that should be included in the report. Of course, I cannot include everything, but I try to summarize all the information that we are collecting and we are presenting in the United Nations that gives more legitimate voice to all of you in relation to these things. So it's very important for me to be here. And then what are the key principles? There are important key principles in the UNFCCC convention, first of all. There is no question the convention has no problem. Convention has everything. If you are a lawyer and if you read the convention, you'll find everything there. But the lawyers are also interpreting the convention depending on which side they are. Are they from the government side? Are they from the civil society side, or are they from the corporate interest? So we have the document, but we have various kind of players to play with this document. If we look at the last 20 years that we are now in the 21, COP21, which means we have been doing this 21 years, we were very slow to go, and I mentioned already early in the morning that the food security and the human rights concept came very, very late after 2011, so we are some kind of baby steps there, and I'm not even sure we will be stay in the Paris end of the Paris document. We try to be in the document. So you all are responsible. We all are responsible to raise our voice that we have to have a certain kind of human rights principles. Which is very important because as we talk over and over again, voluntary principles, we are not going anywhere. We have to find something to give legitimacy, to give accountability, to give entitlement to right holders. And the right bearers have to be responsible. These are basically governments. But as you know, when we talk about the food security, governments are not only players, and the corporate interests are extremely important, and it came over and over again in our meetings, and corporate responsibility should be definitely dealt in a very kind of comprehensive manner, not only guiding principles that we have been doing right now, because voluntary guiding principles are not very easy, and they are very much manipulated by the players. And especially in developing countries, the governments are not strong enough because they are much more development oriented. They are part, in order to make the developmental principles, they are saying yes to many kind of very questionable projects. So if we have the human rights approach in the convention or in the legal document, then the civil societies can mobilize and they can stop such kind of dangerous or violations against right to food or livelihood of the people. So I'm talking about over and over and over again the importance of the human rights principles. Unfortunately, the international law and the current United Nations system is extremely fragmented. We are not part of the UNFCCC as a United Nations Human Rights Council. And UNFCCC has its own entity, has its own member countries, and the other international UN organizations have no say in the UNFCCC. For instance, I am not part of the UNFCCC as a Human Rights Council Special Rapporteur Right to Food, neither Special Rapporteur Right to Environment, nor the Special Rapporteur Right to Food or Indigenous People. We keep going to various kind of COP meetings, and we talk inside events and telling them, you really have to pay attention to this, but we never be able to to be a part of it. So that's the one issue. I don't think we're going to be able to solve this because a current international law system doesn't allow to do that. And the sovereignty of the states are another important issue. Because of the sovereignty of the states, we cannot interfere many of the decision-making processes in the COP. We have to have find a friendly government, and we have to work together with them. Unfortunately, in another unfortunate issue, I always start with unfortunately, it is very sad, of course. In our global system, the global problems cannot be solved our current system, which is basically sovereign-oriented United Nations or sovereign-oriented. We talk about the modernity. If modernity gave us to this sovereignty, there is a little bit danger on that because when we talk about the sovereignty, we cannot really solve many of the issues because we talk about the poverty, we talk about the hunger, and who are these people? Are they governments? Yes, partly. For instance, 48 of the least developed countries are part of the countries that they have a legitimate voice, which is UNFCCC gave them a legitimate voice also. But the rest of the countries, for instance, we were talking about the India, we are talking about China, we are talking about many Latin American countries. Many of the people live there $1.25 a day. Are these people that excluded from our UNFCCC principles? According to this system, yes, because they only have to act what their governments can say. So that system is very, very difficult to solve this problem. I think I should stop here, otherwise. I have 2 minutes. Okay. The another issue is, for instance, when we talk about the food security, what kind of organizations are dealing with the food security? As you know, FAO and Committee of Food Security, which recently established in 2009, actually it is not recently established, but they are a sort of reform in 2009 that included a civil society organization, which is very novel. There are not many versions of the intergovernmental organizations like that. So Committee of Food Security is an important place to make the policy, food policy issues. This is one part. But the UNFCCC, they are not part of this food security, food policy issues. They only deal with the climate change. But the Committee of Food Security took this responsibility because of the connection with the climate change and the food security. They had this 2013 report making very strong connection and what are the problems in the UNFCCC that we should recorrect, and they had some kind of recommendations that we can keep repeat here besides our recommendations that we can do it at the end of the meeting. This is an important part, but again, they are not part of the UNFCCC. If we look at lastly, I'm talking about a little bit UN Human Rights Council. Since 2008, UN Human Rights Council is working very seriously about including food including economic and social rights to the climate change connection. And they had several kind of resolutions. They have four resolutions, and we didn't go anywhere yet, but we are expecting maybe we will do maybe 5, 6, 7, 8 resolution later, just a little sentences here and there. And these things, of course, very much connected with the personal relationships. Mary Robinson was an important person playing in this role to include the human rights principles very recently because she was very friendly with many of the governments, especially Costa Rica, Philippines, and the countries that in Latin America that they were able to include. The women empowerment, again, was included to COP meetings because it was in the Mexico. The Mexican foreign minister was female, and they were very close friend with the Cristina Figueras. Then they include the women empowerment there. So We all have a responsibility. If we have a friends from the government, we should talk to them. We should convince them what we should do. These small steps, sometimes it brings the bigger solutions. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Hilal. And before I pass the floor to our second panelist, I'd just like to tell you that because there are five of us, because it's the end of the day, we'll have some questions straight away afterwards so that we can carry on keeping the debate lively. So start preparing your questions already. For Hilal, Hilal spoke about certain principles and approach based on our rights and binding engagements and the difficult role of the private sector and the need for regulation, as well as the need for some of the countries whose voices are least heard to make proposals. So my question is, what is Senegal's position? What are you expecting in terms of agricultural challenges and food security in terms of the climate agenda, and what does the African countries have done in this regard? So thank you. I'd like to begin by congratulating you for the wonderful organization and for having invited me here today in order to address you. A couple of points in terms of what's being done in Africa, and Senegal is often mentioned as an example amongst other countries. When it comes to negotiations, the criticism was that food security wasn't in the text, that it appeared in the preamble and in the section on adaptation. Just a couple of reminders when it comes to what happened during the negotiations in terms of the benefits of including this in a text. For sub-Saharan Africa and the ADP, when it comes to agriculture, when we speak about food safety in the new text, they talk about food several times. Food security maybe appears twice or three times. But the texts, as they appear, don't really reflect the practice, because what's most important for us is what happens operationally speaking. When we look at the adaptation fund, we had to look at issues relative to tourism. So all of this to say,
vous pouvez aussi convenir avec moi que la négociation climat, le UNFCCC, c'est le mécanisme le plus complexe.
UNFCCC is probably the most complex of all the multilateral agreements when it comes to environment. When we speak about the ozone layers, there was the Montreal Protocol. It wasn't really problematic because it was very simple. There was gases that needed to be reduced, and there were no other alternatives. Whereas here, we want to reduce gas emissions that heat up the atmosphere, but there's so many other aspects to it that when we have forums like this, you think that food security should lie at the heart of all of it, whereas the objective is to negotiate for the reduction of greenhouse gas emissions. That is what's going to enable the earth to move on the right track. Now, when it comes to Africa, with everything that's been happening, there's two different extremities. You've got either a drought or floods. And so these two extreme conditions aggravate poverty. And so Africa is becoming poorer. And like we've heard repeatedly throughout the day, it's the basic communities that are most affected and that are the most fragile and the most vulnerable. And so this gives rise to situations of famine. A week ago, it was stated in the newspaper that there were three regions that have been heavily affected by famine. And I was lucky enough in coming here on Sunday. I wasn't very familiar with Action Contre la Faim, Action Against Hunger. I'd heard of them, but I'd never really seen them up close. And I saw somebody that was wearing a badge that said ACF, and I followed that person, and I stopped that person. It was the Senegalese representative in Senegal. They came from the Mor region in the north, and he told me that it all boils down to poverty. It's very... So I got his business card, And I'm planning to become a big fan of ACF once I get back home, and to be in touch with him once I get back home. Now, what can we do in order for the food system to be taken into account? So somebody said that revolutions need to take place from the bottom up, but I think that these aren't opposing forces. The government. Government is an easy continent when it comes to working with NGOs. All NGOs can be part of the African local delegations. When we put together our delegation to go to the negotiating table, we have the National Committee on Climate Change, everybody's present. And the committees, the associations, and the NGOs are all there. And if somebody asks for a badge to be part of the delegation, they get given the badge. Because if you look at Senegal and the position on the African continent, we might not always be in favor of it, but that's off the record. But that's what happens. Everybody is involved. And we need to see where the need lies and to be smart in terms of where we get involved and smart in terms of our assessments. When food security or agriculture or fishing, etc., it's all in well to have policies, but we need to have means to implement those policies. Otherwise, it just stays as a principle and it serves no purpose. So there's a lot of things that need to be done on a national level. And on a national level, all the African countries, somebody said, since 1994, since I've been involved in negotiations, Senegal has never had less than 4 people. I know it's not enough. Somebody said that African countries were underrepresentative. It's true that if there's only 2 people, then they can't do much. But Africa is organized in such a way that you've got national groups. And there's coordination. And so even though there are few representatives, we do coordinate and we try to understand what's happening. And so we get together, we sit down around the table, and we also have friends within the NGOs. We have a confederation of NGOs in Senegal, and these confederations also participate. From a strategic point of view, what we've looked to do is we've looked to develop projects. If you remember, in Copenhagen, and even before Copenhagen, Senegal was the very first national entity to become involved in the adaptation fund. And with and we went. It's almost like the Green Climate Fund. We pushed in a certain direction, and there were very few countries. And so I'll come back to that in a moment. But we go where others don't tend to go. Now, when it comes to the Green Fund, we were allocated $8 million, and 2 were attributed to a women's association called Dynamique Femme in Senegal. We trusted them, and we gave them the means to build a dig over 5 kilometers. There was agricultural fields, there was pasture fields, and there was water. And the water was seeping in. And we built this wall along the ocean's edge. And when it rained, it stored the water. And the water was kept for 8 months. And it was the adaptation fund. The money was received and it was given directly to these women, and there was a follow-up. And there are other organizations as well that have come together and worked together. So on the whole, I think all the African countries, when the money gets money from the Green Fund, it generally does go to the communities. At least in any event, it's not possible for it to be diverted elsewhere in Senegal. It goes through to the communities. Now, I'd like to come very quickly to negotiations. In terms of negotiations, we need to be able to carry on using the right references, inserting getting the right references, insofar as possible, these need to be inserted into the text. Because when you insert something into the text, you need to think about how it can be applied and customized so that it can be applicable to the population. This morning, somebody said that Africa only goes to the table for money, which is not just to find money, but they are entrusted with certain responsibilities. When you really got to, they have a role to fulfill, and everybody knows that developed countries have failed when it comes to several policies. And today, where we stand, the NDC was one of the latest creations. You were also saying this morning that we never managed to understand before we go on to the next issue. And we've had... today, we've arrived at the NDC. If we look at the NDC just for a couple of seconds, this is probably... it's the most unclear mechanisms. It's really not a clear mechanism. Why? Because this was a mechanism that was imposed. It was almost as if we put the cart before the horse. There was no room for everybody to adapt. It's open to interpretation. It's wide open to interpretation. There's no standard way of interpreting it. And so the group against hunger and for food security, initially, the focus was on attenuation, on mitigation. I wasn't very much in favor with that. And the LDC group, they removed the word adaptation and just included the word attenuation because LDC is understood as being about mitigation and attenuation. When you look at food safety, we seek to make a smart contribution. So what I'm trying to say here, just to wrap up before we leave for questions, is that Africa, when I arrive at a meeting and when I don't have a stance, sometimes I listen to see what the NGOs are saying, and that's the stance that I adopt. But we have never been against anything. We've always acted together, and I would really like somebody to say to me one day, to tell me an example where we had differing opinions. So today everybody's saying insert food considerations everywhere. But when I write about food considerations, sometimes I prefer not to write the word food. When there's money, when it comes to agriculture, when I create a dig for the sea, it's to have water for the populations, for agriculture, and for everybody to work together. So we need to adopt a smart approach, and that's how we need to move forward. And we're open. We have been open in Bonn. We have been open in Paris. We're open to your input. And we welcome any ideas that will help us to think, because this is an issue that involves everybody.
Merci beaucoup. Je pense que ce sera un élément à discuter. Effectivement, inclure alimentaire dans le texte. Après, il faut une cohérence des politiques sur le terrain.
We need funding. We need capacity. We have the agreement, the COP agreement, and also topics for APTEC. So we're going to floor two questions here very quickly, and we're going to go into these issues a little bit deeper, but with the help of the questions that you're going to put to us. So are there a couple of questions? I come from Senegal. I'm a member of the civil society. I want to ask a question of the leader of the UN. Are we going to have a binding agreement for terms of equity? If we use the example of China and America, it's 40% of the greenhouse gases come from these. It's the third countries that suffer the most from them. If the UN is there to equip, to be for equity, are we going to have mandatory laws passed with this agreement? and to commit to commitments that they have to respect, or is it going to be a diplomatic agreement without support, any principal support, and everybody can do what they do? I'll give you an example. Clinton committed in Copenhagen, but he never adhered to it because there was too much pressure from the country itself. Now, is Obama, is he going to make a commitment in the Paris conference, which is either going to be ratified or not by his Congress? But this, it's a matter of equity. We are, what we're expecting from this conference, we don't want it to be a diplomatic conference, but we want to put this in the balance. You talk about the conference and the ANC that has a binding agreement, is different, which sanctioned countries like the United States and Europe, which is the reason I think that at the heart of the issue, the sovereignty is there, of course, but what the third world countries are waiting for is an expression of solidarity, that we're going to reach an agreement, in fact, which is really going to show some real support, that the polluters are going to pay for the pollution, and they're going to pay the developing countries, and we don't want diplomacy and just pretty words. And so this is the question: is it going to be a binding agreement or not, or is it just going to be diplomacy as usual? And we are expecting agreements with sanctions, that the polluters are going to be the payers, and they're not just in the third world countries that respect the emissions of the greenhouse gases, when we are faced with countries like China, like the United States, which emits 40% of the GHGs into the country. Why is it that the countries from the third world, and so there has to be a law that is going to be imposed on all the states, and there's not going to be an agreement, which is going to be in the country, in the international, and I'm sorry. So we have two questions from Twitter. It's a general question. How can we ensure that food security is not going to be seen as just a trade-off? And so, how is not going to be taken as a hostage in the, are they going to arrive at something else very similar to the previous question? The second question, what would you say to South Africa, which is offering a tax which is going to replace food security by increased food production? And if we have time, what countries are going to see in Bonn next week? And this is going to, I'll reserve the question for the three panelists. It's about a mandatory, about a binding agreement in Paris, and Sheikh's question about, is it going to be a trade-off? Are we going to negotiate on the kind of funding or other political element? Is there a danger this is going to be the poor parent of the Paris agreements?
Thank you. It's the binding agreement is a big question. If you remember, this came two, three cups before. And the countries were not even able to put in a one sentence that the nature of the agreement. This is absolutely crazy. I mean, and then at the end, I think India and Brazil try to make kind of compromising that some sort of legal power or something. I don't remember right now the real language, but the languages are very important. So we don't know yet, but I would assure you 90% it will not be legally binding, because as you said, the geopolitics of the climate change is very clear, and the most powerful players are not into making kind of more mandatory commitment. Already we have this nationally intended commitments for the greenhouse gas emissions. This is, if you remember, it started in 2009 in the Obama was the COP 15, and still we are in this kind of voluntary ideas. So at least greenhouse gas emission promise is voluntary. But I don't know at the end of the Paris, which is the host countries are very, very important. If the France is makes really clear step against this voluntary, there's a possibility that all the direction would change. Obama is very much promising very strong climate change policies, but as you said, there is a very unfriendly Congress. He's not going to be able to bring anything to Washington, D.C. that will be mandatorily binding for the United States. But he can still make the diplomatic kind of leadership to make the more mandatory, but I am not sure about that will be acceptable. European Union is playing a better, more constructive role, but there is also developing countries, for instance, China is still in the part of the G77, which they are representing the developing countries, interestingly enough, but they are playing a kind of double-edged game, and depending on what will happen among the G77 group. So there are many things will happen, and I am sure at the end of the 2 weeks, they will give them 48 hours extra time. And this 48 hours, nobody is going to go to sleep to their home. And then at the end, there will be some kind of language, and everybody will clap and will end. And we'll come to next meeting at COP22. And in relation to, should I answer also the other one? Okay. Thank you.
Sila, rapidement, alors de question de... Est-ce
qu'on risque de... Do we say to negotiate food security? Do we change food security for food production? Is that acceptable? Is that something we want to do? I'm not specialist in all this, but I think food security is much much better for us. But in the context of Africa, but I think it's in fact that would suit us much better. The second point concerning the equity and the binding agreements, I think we have to be very careful in relation to that. What does equity mean? It is we have to draw a treaty that everybody is going to commit to. If I remind you, there was no commitment to that. We tried to arrive at voluntary commitments in the agenda that wasn't adapted, and we had to withdraw it because this voluntary element. Later, equity didn't work, and we then asked the NDC after that to determine that. When we have it has to be legally binding, if I have to make a contribution, national contribution, it's going to be a voluntary or a planned intervention. The planned things, when the national contributions where we're going to include legal binding, but I think we have to delete it between 2030-2040. We have to negotiate and become very clear and put the countries before their commitments. And if we ask that of China, China is going to say, okay, I will contribute, but for everybody else, it has to be funded. And where are we going to find the funding? The funding by China is going to have an impact on the funding to Africa, because the Chinese can gobble up all the, in fact, the money that's going to be contributed to the African countries. And yet, we're still not very clear about the NDC. I think this is a good transition, and we're going to give the floor to Ludovic. What can we hope from the summit? What is France going to go for in agriculture? And can we hope, or do we have to fear? We've talked about equity in agriculture. It's very important. What are the expectations, and where do we stand today in that? Just before that, I want to react to this question about whether it's going to be legally binding or not. The objective is to arrive at a legally binding document, and this is the will of the French president. After that, it depends on the international community, but for the moment, there is nothing that, that exists at the ONC. And then part of it, which is going to structure the convention, it's very difficult to force a country to respect their commitments. And it might be denounced by the NGOs, but there is very difficult to talk about binding laws. What we want to try and arrive at is that now concerning the agriculture, just to give an idea of the framework of the negotiations, it's a topic which is fairly recent. It came to the negotiation in 2011 in Durban. And in Copenhagen already, there were a group of countries working on the question of agriculture, but the text was not agreed on, generally speaking, because there were people more or less for it. But we are already working on agriculture in Copenhagen, but it was truly in Durban where the agriculture was incorporated into the technological scientific convention that we arrived to in Durban. The convention exists between 1972, but it is not structured in a sectorial way, and that's one particularity of it in funding and technology transfer and transfer of capacity. And so we're not going to talk about any specific sector. So that always created a tension. Should we talk about sectors in particular, or should we continue to talk about them in a cross-sectional way? And so we've already opened up a breach with the mechanism for forests and for deforestation. But we're going along the same lines with agriculture, but with a very sectorial approach in 2011, with the discussions, and which proved to be very conflictual, especially because of the binding aspect of it. So it's issues related that turn around agriculture. And we can talk about adaptation and mitigation, and we talk about that for all the countries. And we can, it's not just the developing countries, but we are really going to try and include all the countries, big and small. When we talked about that, adaptation and mitigation, this also complicates the debate a little bit, because the less specific we are, the more the potential is to raise suspicions among countries. And more recently, we made some progress in June 2014. There was a working program on agriculture, which was approved by a series of workshops in Bonn this year and next year about adaptation. The political compromises that emerged from these discussions on agriculture to date is to say, let's move forward on adaptation because it's a topic which is more consensually agreed upon. And then after that, mitigation, we'll see more about that later. And we may discuss this in COP21. And the issues involved here, where the countries don't necessarily want to move forward, so they're advancing very carefully. And so this point of the agenda is going to continue to live. And if everything goes well, after Paris, the political tension may have fallen a little bit, and there we may be able to tackle the question of mitigation and all the synergies involved that go along with mitigation. Now, concerning the positioning, this is going to be a bit of an exaggeration, but we have the developing countries that push the issue of mitigation in the negotiations fairly early because they had one burning domestic question. And then what do we do about emissions that are agriculturally based? Now, faced with that, there were a group of countries very closed on this issue. The emerging countries, Argentina, India, Egypt, Brazil, and China being a little less clear in their intentions. Whether they were going to be included in the same group or not, but in fact they said it was impossible to tackle the issue of mitigation. The more we're going to talk about it, the more we're going to restrain the conversation on it. And so the African group was sort of between two chairs here. They were in favor of adaptation, but not having a very firm position concerning mitigation. And so we had this discussion, was grouped around two poles, about adaptation or mitigation. And that blocked up over a two-year period before 2014, when we made a first step moving toward adaptation by focusing on adaptation so that we can move slightly forward a little bit. And so what can we expect from the Paris conference? Objectively speaking, in terms of security, you've understood it's a very complex question, and we have a very difficult time moving forward in past years. I think one of the signals is the fact that we have to conserve food security as an important point in the Geneva text, or in the food text in the preamble to it. There were several mentions of the fact that we mustn't threaten food production. And this is the text that comes from Article 2 of the Convention as well. But we know there are a certain number of countries and civil societies which are pushing for food security motion. But I don't think any country is frankly against that. We talked about South Africa, who were asking how much of it is a tactical maneuver. But the notion of food security is broad, is a polemical issue, and which can be understood in many different ways. But there is a kind of consensus that goes along with it. After that, there is a need, nonetheless, that the accountability of all these issues, that the countries are going to be able to give accounts of their carbon emissions, for example, nonetheless, but with the contributions which are going to arrive throughout about 2015, is that the agricultural sector or the forestry culture contributions are going to be made. And so what we have to try to do is to move forward the biggest and the broadest coverage as possible. So adaptation, nobody is against it. It's a crucial topic for food security. But it's very important with time for the developing countries. And if we are going to commit the developing countries, especially if they are going to commit statistically to this, they also have to engage in this, that the agricultural sector can be accountable or be made accountable. We cannot put this on the same level, family agriculture, family farming, which is self-sufficient in the value chain, that is going to be productive for the agro industry, and we have to try to find the means to go beyond this kind of tension. We cannot ask the small cultivators in the farmers in the south to agree with this, but in a more general way, there is a direct way we also have the emergence of the agenda of solutions with a certain number of initiatives which are carried in multi-partnership on the international level by Ban Ki-moon in September of 2014. In the farming sector, the agricultural sector, the Global Alliance for Intelligence Agriculture, it raised many questions because it wasn't accepted by some of the countries, but also by most civil societies. And so a lot of questions were raised about how we can carry the issue of agriculture on the agenda in the perspective of the Paris conference. The agroecology as well, the French government is pushing for agroecology on the international stage. But there are very few countries, in fact, who are following France, but there is France leading that fight. There is an article which defines the concept of agroecology and which recommends that the French agriculture moves toward agroecology in its practices, in its methods, in the future. And so this was adopted in October 2014. And so I'll finish. And so to conclude, I think I'm taking a little bit more time. And so to think about this carrying the agricultural question, we haven't exactly set on things yet. The initiatives on the bottom line are going to be established by the Ministry of Agriculture. When we talk about the bottom line, is going to be a central thing, and we have to improve the arability of the soil and to bring aid to those populations who are most vulnerable. And this project, which is being worked out, is aiming also before the Paris conference to talk about the issue of the earth and everything we talked about before. We have to worry about the land grab and things like that. So what we can expect from other things from the Paris conference to maintain the agriculture in the context itself, and the Geneva text is the only mention of agriculture in the whole text under negotiation at the moment. And perhaps we can rely on that to see how we might be able to imagine between 2015, 2016, a mechanism which would instigate the inclusion of this in the text and adaptation and mitigation, and to ask the countries what they consider the priorities. What we can expect for the moment, then, to conclude, it's a topic, it's a very important topic, it's a recent topic, which hasn't found its proper space in the negotiations yet, but it's a future topic. It's not easy because it does create cleavages. But I think the underlying elements that in the years to come, I think it might be very important for grounding and to continue the discussion on agriculture and to be able to move forward on solutions which are more consensual. Thank you.
So thanks, Ludovic. Thank you, Ludovic. And I'm going to pass over the floor to Elie. We have started to hear about what can be included in the climate agenda and what we could hope from Paris or Marrakech. So what is the civil society in Africa and in Nigeria asking? What should be obtained in the Paris Agreement?
Thank you.
La question posée now, ici, c'est the question here faire une place is à la sécurité how can food safety find its place within the climate negotiations?
La position de la société
and Africa's civil society's position and the climate network has been very clear in this regard.
On a déjà eu l'occasion de suivre, donc, cette thématique
we I have been dealing with this. We followed up on this issue from Lima right through to Geneva, where food security was inserted in certain parts of the text, but that's not the problem.
S'il faut se demander comment donc
the question is, how can food security be taken into account within these texts? And I think it needs to be looked at from several angles. We have to first ask, what do we have already? What do we have in hand? And what is problematic, if anything is causing a problem? So what do we have in hand? We have a text from Geneva, which is a text that has a lot of options. And unfortunately, food safety is part of those options, and options that by Paris might actually be taken out of the text. So what do we have to do is we have to make sure It's really in the options that it has to remain present right through to Paris. So that is the view of civil society of French-speaking Africa. Another problem, or one of the problems, is that the text makes reference to several articles of the convention. So, legally speaking, this might give rise to some concerns if those texts are to prevail. So, we need to be a little bit a step ahead or a little bit cleverer than those that are writing the text. Another problem, and something that really disgusts me and that really makes me sad, is that when we speak about food safety, are those countries that are most affected, which countries are they? They're the southern countries. It's not the U.S. that have problems of food safety, and not even the Saudi Arabia. So, I don't see any African country who is carrying the flag of food safety in the negotiations. That's a problem. That's something we have to be looking at. In Geneva recently, in February, Saudi Arabia should have been putting forward the proposal and should have been ensuring that food safety was included in the text. And that's a problem for me because I don't know why Saudi Arabia needs to support the insertion of food safety in the text. Are they supporting this because they're saying, okay, we've managed to get food safety in there? What is their end game? Is it to say, okay, we want to negotiate something else and later they're going to stand behind something else? So that's really a worry. If it's just Niger who asked for food safety to be added into the text, then you can understand. Then you don't really have to worry. But Saudi Arabia, that's a problem. We really need to probe deeper to find out what's happening there, and that's one of the challenges. Another challenge, with the possibility and the capacity of Africans to participate in these big forums, without the support of the northern countries, I don't know if the African countries can really see this through to the end in a valid manner. So we need to reinforce the capacity of the African states to intervene. And the food safety boat has to be driven right through to Paris. We need to make sure that it gets to destination Paris. And like it's already been said, we can try and explore issues relative to agriculture. Agriculture was mentioned 5 times in the text. So 5 times. Once under funding, and the question of food production was mentioned 5 times in the text. So, for those of you who have the text, you can look at page 1, 2, 6, 9, and 10. There is the mention of food production. Now, is this also an opportunity for us? Because it's an option, in any event, because it's an option, it doesn't fall within any of the articles of the convention. Do we have any leeway? Can we try and get food safety in there via agriculture? Now, when it comes to agriculture, it's mentioned in page 34 in the paragraph that deals with financing. And once again, what agriculture are they talking about? Yeah. Is this agriculture that can guarantee food safety? Then okay, then we're not that badly off. But if it's agriculture that refers to something else, it could, then maybe agriculture shouldn't be in that text. It's, when they talk about agriculture, it should be agriculture that will contribute to ensuring and creating conditions for food safety. Not that which is going to create food insecurity, such as promoting genetically modified organisms or biofuel crops. Now, when it comes to the recommendations, we know what the ideas are. We have solutions to provide for better food security, but they're not being applied. And why is that? It is because people have opted for a certain logic. So I'd like to thank parliamentarian Durand, who spoke about the profit-based logic that's in play. He said that people want immediate profit, and it doesn't matter what the means are. And what are the means? The means are creating further food insecurity. It's food security that pays the price. And the earth is for all of us. It's not. We're not Africans. We're not Europeans. We're a single population of earth. And I think that we need to see how we can ensure food safety for everybody. And this is not an issue for tomorrow. This is an issue to be decided today.
Merci.
Thank you very much.
Merci, Ali. Merci beaucoup.
So
justement,
thank you. And
so
we just wanted to
continue à aller dans le sujet,
finish off with a concrete example and speak about
Niger,
what's being done in the field in Niger. So we can see that there are solutions. We've heard about this the whole day through. Are there any solutions? Are there any politicians that are helping to promote these solutions? What are those solutions? How can we loop the loop? If we have a political agreement but we don't have any concrete projects, then we know that things aren't going to advance. So I'm going to hand over the floor to ECP Bourama, who's going to tell us about concrete projects that are in the pipeline in Niger. So thank you very much, Emily. I'd just like to specify something. I am not a political advisor.
Je suis conseiller technique,
I am a technical advisor
and expert
in environment and sustainable development. People in all countries, you don't only have politicians surrounding the president, you've also got the experts and you've got technical people as well. So I'd like to start off by thanking the ACF. And with all its partner organizations that have enabled me
de venir
to
ici
come and address you here today at this big conference, which is even an international conference,
pour pouvoir échanger,
in order to be able to discuss.
Échanger parce que c'est un cadre spécial,
this is
un cadre
a very specific framework that brings together government representatives and members of civil society. So this morning, we listened to certain of our brothers from African society that tend to show that there's a certain antagonism. But it depends on the country, though.
Demandé de parler d'une stratégie nationale.
I was asked to speak about national strategy.
Que, au niveau du public, and
maybe some of you have read about it on the internet or heard about the Troian initiative.
En fait, cette politique, cette
this new policy, which has been implemented in Nigeria for
the
last 4 years,
de vous d'un
what I'd like you to tell you about it is I'd like to just set the scene for you, tell you about the context,
expliquer, en fait,
just to explain
la de cette
how this policy came about and how it was implemented.
Niger, à l'instar des pays, tous les pays
Niger, like all the Sahelian countries,
tout est un environnement physique très
has very unfavorable physical conditions.
There's
the combined effect of a number of environmental factors, as well as social, political, and economic factors. So the environmental factors are structural, but there is continued desertification. Most of our surface area is in a desert state. And just a story, quite recently when the Pope received President Hollande,
L'homme peut pardonner une seule fois.
Man can
Dieu
forgive,
peut pardonner une seule fois, mais la nature
man
ne peut jamais
forgives
pardonner.
Once, God forgives twice, but
donc,
nature
la
never forgives.
So, on continue à vivre avec,
desertification is something that we
chaque
live with. We don't
Dieu
have a choice. Every
year
provided to us by God is every year that the desert
au-delà
expands.
De cette desertification,
but beyond the desertification, there's also climatic
aujourd'hui,
les changements
climatiques et la variabilité
climatique and climatic variations. And that spares
mais
nobody.
De façon structurelle, il y a des pays
there
qui
are countries
avec
that are surviving with these climatic variations. That's important. And our country is part of a country that just has
donc
to live with
climatic
change and climatic variations.
And so all
these factors combined with the other social, political, and structural factors. So rising demographics, social inequalities. When we talk about social inequalities, this is the fact that people don't know how to read and write, that people aren't at school, and that there's extreme poverty. This also.
Des instabilités politiques
we also have a political instability and that we've suffered from since the years of independence.
Que, cela, ans plus
and
tôt,
so it was on the basis of
le
all this that our head of state, 4 years ago,
at
the time was running for the presidential elections, he submitted a political
program
which was called a program
dans
for the renaissance
3,
of the rebirth of Niger.
Il y avait une vision qui était là,
which he called
vision
the 3-in initiative.
Le principe suivant.
So this was based on the following principle.
Il disait qu'il a fait 20 ans l'opposition, il a parcouru toutes les politiques sectorielles que le Niger a mises en œuvre de 1960
right through to 2000.
Mais cela n'a pas empêché que nous connaissons, nous avons connu
but
plusieurs crises alimentaires.
We still went through
donc
several
on a tendance
food
à dire au
Niger,
la persistance
and
des crises alimentaires,
so
on a le terme
crises,
de recrudescence des crises alimentaires, les crises alimentaires récurrentes.
Recurring food crises,
donc, sur la base de ce constat,
so
cette initiative
this initiative was then drafted, compiled, and the strategy was promulgated and came into force as of 2011. So one of the questions was, how was this policy different to the others? We have been a state since 1960. We've had other policies that have come into force since the 60s. The difference here was,
comment on appelle ça là? Considérez-moi l'expression.
The expression that we use is it was a popular strategy
because
it was a strategy based on a political vision which was sanctioned by popular approval because when the president presented his program, most of the population had read it and so the population were already on board. They were already in support of this vision.
Après cela, quand il est venu au pouvoir,
then when he came into power, he instructed the government to
décliner sa vision en stratégie d'action.
To turn this vision into an action strategy.
On ne peut pas empêcher qu'il y ait des
sécheresses
au Niger.
We can't prevent droughts in Niger because that is the work of
mais
nature.
Il dit, il veut
but what he wanted to do is he wanted to create the conditions whereby we can warn
ça,
of hunger and famine upstream of
en fait,
the drought.
De cette vision. L'autre point qui fait
point,
que cette politique
that made this policy different to the former policy.
C'est la phase de consultation.
There was a consultation phase that was built in.
À toutes les parties prenantes.
And this involved
auparavant,
all the stakeholders.
Fait.
This was something that
mais
was done before.
D'après,
but,
quand même, parce qu'il y a
this,
là,
there was the presence of actors
d'après
from civil
acteurs,
society.
Il n'y avait pas eu une
and
politique nationale.
We've never had
a
national policy
une phase de consultation aussi élargie,
phase, which included as many stakeholders, such as that included in the 3N initiative.
Sa formulation a pris en compte
and
aussi
so the way it was formulated also took into account emerging questions, such as empowerment of the women
un aspect aussi
and
très important
gender equality. So another important aspect when it came to strategic planning
logique et axé sur le
is that it was results-based and not means-based. And that was very important
dans
because in
c'est
what
où
happened in the
notre,
past.
Nos planifications
in the past,
sont axées sur
the planning always focused on an objective
on se
préoccupe
juste à réaliser des produits,
so
faire un puits,
they would
faire
just,
une classe,
build the product,
on se soucie
build
pas,
a well,
fait,
build
est-ce
a
que
square.
C'est la préoccupation réelle
but they didn't really see if it really was
est-ce
in line with the real concerns of the population and how
c'est
they were using it after the fact. So just a story.
Nous faisons régulièrement
on a regular basis,
une mission mixte cabinet de la présidence,
have a mixed session between the cabinet of the presidency and the cabinet of the ministry. So we have 103 communes within Niger, and we follow up on the activities carried out under three initiatives.
On est arrivé dans une zone nomade.
There was a nomadic zone.
On a Nord Dakoro.
North Dakoro.
On connaît la zone. Et dans cette zone, nous avons été accueillis par les communautés locales,
and so the tribal chiefs.
Et nous avons discuté avec
and
eux.
We,
nous avons fait comprendre que l'un des chefs,
écoutez, that one of the chiefs,
nous, la première satisfaction qu'on va vous faire part, c'est que nous sommes contents de vos actions. On leur a dit, on lui a dit, pourquoi?
And we said, why are you so happy?
Et maintenant, on a compris qu'il y a une nouvelle donne. Les gens nous consultent pour savoir est-ce qu'entre une classe, un puits, lequel on veut immédiatement à moyen terme, à court terme, à moyen terme.
Dans le passé, ce n'est pas ça.
Et eux, ils voient seulement des opérateurs qui viennent, ils font un puits. Et aussi, à cause de leur dignité, ils n'utilisent pas. Parce qu'on ne les a pas aussi.
Donc,
voyez-vous,
ils
nous ont même expliqué
une histoire.
Dans le passé, il y a
de
pouvoir le dire, un partenaire, une organisation internationale, qui a construit un puits pastoral. Mais ils ont dit que ce puits pastoral était resté pendant longtemps, que les nomades ne l'utilisaient pas, parce que tout simplement, ils ont remarqué que dans la zone, c'était les sédentaires qui étaient associés, en fait, à la réalisation du puits. Donc eux, les nomades, on ne les a pas associés, mais pourtant, le c'est un puits pastoral, ils ne veulent pas l'utiliser, ils ne veulent pas l'utiliser. Donc, toutes ces questions montrent que c'est vraiment important à la fois d'associer les populations.
Et
un de nos frères ce matin a utilisé le terme
«
impliqué », ça c'est très important, c'est vrai. On peut participer à quelque chose sans pour être réellement impliqué au plus haut niveau. Parce que tant que vos préoccupations ne sont pas prises en compte, vous n'êtes pas impliqué. C'est vrai. Donc au-delà de ce point aussi, dans les principes directeurs,
de
la mise en œuvre de l'initiative, un aspect aussi important qui diffère de cette politique des précédentes, c'est que tout va de comment on appelle ça la Duba. Ce matin aussi, nous sommes assurés que tout soit porté par les collectivités, les communes, et par les organisations de producteurs. C'est-à-dire que des projets ne sont pas financés à titre individuel à partir de la portion centrale. Tout est porté au niveau des communes. C'est au niveau des communes qu'on fait l'arbitrage des projets de la commune. Et ça part au niveau départemental, au niveau régional, jusqu'au niveau national. Et ceci est sanctionné par, à travers un dispositif institutionnel qui va de l'exécutif jusqu'en bas. Il y a des cadres de concertation, cadres de concertation, État, partenaire technique et financier, cadres de concertation, État, société civile, cadres de concertation, secteur privé, cadres de concertation, municipalité. Et tous ces cadres de concertation sont dynamiques. Régulièrement, ils fonctionnent régulièrement. Il y a des rencontres qui se font régulièrement pour la suivre l'évaluation des activités au niveau national. Pour le cadre de concertation, par exemple, au niveau étatique, chaque fin de mois, il y a une rencontre des ministères qui interviennent dans le cadre de l'initiative. Il y a une rencontre autour du président de la République, son premier ministre, les ministres en charge de l'Ouest rural et les principaux conseillers pour faire le point au cours du mois. C'est
and so every month,
d'intervention.
They get together and talk about what's been done,
fait,
what hasn't been done, and why that which
par
hasn't
mois,
been done wasn't done every month. So the head of state takes the time himself to make sure what's happening.
Maintenant, voyons par rapport à quelques résultats illustratifs. Okay, d'accord. C'est très important.
It's very important to say.
En dépit de la mise en
œuvre, despite the implementation of this initiative,
nous avons connu
we experienced 2 years. A deficit years on the agricultural plane, but what was special about that is because it didn't enable us to because the activities are operated because of this initiative. This enabled us to keep the people informed and to improve their revenue because they are basically based on local activities in the fields and to enable them to have access to the market.
J'ai bien voulu avoir
I'd like to also talk about the constraints that came along with it. So 30 seconds to talk about the constraints. You cannot talk about success without talking about the constraints. One of the constraints is the galloping demographics, because all the efforts that we put into for cultural levels, we are unable to control the demographics of the country. There's also the issue about the food security, and we can talk about with people about this. The land security is very problematic in our country, and also investment. But I wanted to come to this, and when we come to funding now with our partners, it's easy for them to help us to fund the activities, emergency situations. But when we ask them to help us in development projects, that's much less self-evident. And because we cannot deal with development through emergency measures, and that's very important to keep in mind. So thank you. So we are arriving at the end of the day. So I'm asking our colleagues if we have some very short questions. So we have two questions from the floor, and try and keep them as succinct as possible so that we can continue to exchange among ourselves. Thank you, Emily, and the panelists. My question is directed to the negotiator from Senegal, and I want to come back to this because this morning I've already talked about this a little bit, and this is about the participation of civil society in the negotiations. My colleague said earlier that without support of the northern partners, it's not obvious that the civil society is going to be able to participate in an effective manner in the summit. And I heard you say earlier that in Senegal, you associate the civil society by the fact that when a member of the civil society, you grant that to them, and that's true, and that you are to be congratulated about. In the Cameroon, my own country, it's the same thing. In 2013, I had the occasion to participate in COP19 thanks to a focal point and climate change in Cameroon, and I was able to talk about that. Now, beyond that, there still remains the funding issue, and we both agree that more and more our colleague from Niger, who has just finished speaking, has talked about this. When they, as members of the government, ask for money to implement the projects on a longer term, it's not obvious, and because there's just lack of funding for that. And so if I can come back to the issue of funding, it's clear that if we Africans do not take ourselves in hand on a financial level, it's not going to be done. What are you, as a negotiator, as a member of the government, on this issue, and also this goes for the gentleman from Niger, what could you propose to empower the participation of our civil societies, the African civil societies, within the framework of the negotiations, beyond the mechanisms of funding which exist already, like the MFFC? Because we have it would exist in the country already. How can we mobilize this funding on a local level to be able to ensure the effective participation of everybody? And so I have a very short question also to the negotiator. I'm still a little bit hungry. You talked early about the agenda of solutions and the need to have solutions contributed to by all kinds of players, private society, public society as well, and that you're fairly satisfied that we have a text that makes it possible for everybody to identify with it. Whereas, as other people have said, I would like to have an example, if I may, about what your country, Senegal or France, has refused. You talk about the climatic alibi today. What are you going to maintain? What is the red line in the negotiations beyond which you will not go in the negotiation? So, a final question?
It is kind of a Honorable Ludovic's remarks that the idea of food came late in the picture, and that you are mentioning that at Paris it will probably take in more central role. I'd like to think that would be the way I would like to reflect on that issue as a primary issue of development, really, and to be to that level as a primary issue. Because all our needs, food is the most basic need that we need. And if that is taken care of as development, other developments will fall in place. And also then it's not only food for humankind that is in question, but all creation, all living or other things need food somewhere other. We have to address it also in that global perspective. And also that everything is ordained to become food at the end, somehow or other. Whether materially or spiritually, it becomes kind of a food, or we end our life as not only receiving food, but also giving ourselves as food. So food becomes very central, kind of a cultural, even an ethical issue in all this. So I suppose that Paris, if food could become more centralized in these perspectives, it would be a very nice way of progressing.
Merci pour ces questions. Alors, je reviens peut-être déjà vers ici pour la question de la vie des ONG locales.
Thank you much for local NGOs and the...
Je le remercie d'abord pour
cette First of all, thank you very much for this question, which is very
pour le
touchy.
Cas spécifique du Niger,
but concerning Niger,
je vais parler très à l'aise
I am not going to be very comfortable because we have a member of civil society from Niger who is present here. And so, without perhaps giving him a political asylum,
en fait, au Niger, nous avons une structure
we have a national structure in Niger, which is called the National Council, but it depends on the dynamics of the institution in Niger. One of the vice presidents of this board belongs to the civil society in Niger. Each year for the COP, why the president gets involved in this, because climate, it's a game, it's a diplomatic game as well, but it's also a matter of litigation, because which means that the president gets engaged on the highest level between the various stakeholders. Now, what happens every year with the organization? A committee is implemented, and in the committee, the civil society has a vice presidency given to it. And in the case of funding, projects are presented to the government and also the partners that take part. That is CARE and the French and Danish cooperation and the United States. And they put the projects before the committee. We have a certain number of projects, but specifically for women, for example, or for the youth, or for civil society, and nobody touches those things. But beyond that, we have funding that comes directly through the state societies. And there are certain members of the civil society are not able to read. It's in this quota where the minister can act. And Niger is a part, and it's a shame I'm saying this, but it's one of the poorest countries in Africa.
But
we were not the last in that, because the delegation concluded more than 28 people. And that means that everything depends, as we heard this morning from our friend, Mali friend. We have to involve people on the highest level. We have to listen to them. We have to share with people everything, listen to what they have to say. It's not just what you have to say, but also we have to listen and learn from what you say. In Niger, that's not the problem, but it's not between civil society and government. As the ministry has arrived, the red lines which we cannot talk about, that we do not want to see in the servants, before we talk about the red line, about what's going on in Niger, and to add to that, the National Committee is changing the policies in our regulations. That is the private sector which takes over this. And the committee works within that framework, and this enables us to develop projects and our positioning. Now, in all the projects, they are submitted to everybody, in particular to the ONG, the NGOs and other associations, and they are included in the Senegal's project. But we go toward Peru. We are in the process of preparing a project, and we're going to submit these projects to all the associations working with us in the country. Now, the red lines. But why negotiations aren't moving forward? Because there are red lines. But if there were no red lines, I think they would advance. They would move forward. And so, in relation to the Paris Agreement and the risks that are presented to it, the design is not very clearly defined. If we're going to talk about binding agreements, we have to be clear. But we have to be clear about what we mean by that. But if the words themselves are not properly defined, with the Paris Agreement, I would advise to people the things where we can't move forward too much, because it's going to cause problems. It's going to be on the NDC and on funding. But we're talking about $5 billion today, and we're going to have problems with that. And so if we're going to maintain the principles, and as we see with Morocco and other countries are going to continue contributing to it. So thank you very much. That has to be the conclusive mo. And so it's going to be very difficult to be able to explain myself before the minister. I'm going to try. Now, concerning the agenda for solutions, I think the red line is going. We have to have an initiative which is consensual and which is shared and which offers perspectives. And initiatives which don't bring these conditions together in the perspective of the Paris summit, that can pose problems. In terms of negotiations, I think the red line is to exclude agriculture from the negotiations. And I think it's especially important that we encourage all the countries to act in agriculture in the way they adapt these things. But in the end, we have to be sure that the ambitions over time has to increase, and that the countries include this sector in their strategy, whether it's in matters of adaptation or mitigation. Thank you. And so thank you. Sorry to have to close this panel, but I would invite you to continue the conversation afterwards and to work on the elements of the text, and everybody wants to work on the elements that's going to go into the context.